So we've looked at some of the features of segregated funds now, and we have a fairly substantial understanding of both the big picture and some of the technical details. I want to spend a few minutes here to show why we have these differences between a segregated fund and a mutual fund. That is, where do the differences originate? So let's have a look at a mutual fund to start. And we'll compare that to the structure of a segregated fund. So starting a mutual fund is actually not terribly difficult. You need to go through some regulatory hoops. You need to have some access to some investment professionals. But really, once you have your business structure in place, it's just a matter of going out and getting clients to commit some dollars. And then what we're going to do is we're going to invest those dollars. And hopefully, we will get some gains, interest, dividend, capital gains, whatever. And that money goes back to the client, at which point it's reinvested. It's a simple enough structure. With a mutual fund, you have a disclosure document called a simplified prospectus . That simplified prospectus is vetted by the Securities Commission in the province in which you're active, usually in all provinces. And with the mutual fund, we know that the people running it want to get paid. This is a business, so you have to get paid. So basically, in order to make this process happen, we're going to charge some management fees. And those management fees would be expressed typically as what's called a management expense ratio, which is a percentage of the overall assets of the fund. So this management expense ratio it varies a little bit depending on the type of fund. But for, say, a typical Canadian equity fund, it would be in the range of 2%, give or take. So we might have, for a typical Canadian equity fund, an MER of 2%, which really means that the fund manager, to cover all the expenses associated with making this process work, is going to have to pull 2% of the assets of the fund out, which really means the clients are paying that. They're paying that out of their invested funds. So we would look at the return that our fund manager gets. Let's say our fund manager does a good job and she gets us, let's say, an 8.5% return. And then we have this MER that we have to pay. And let's say we have a 2% MER, just as I've indicated. The end result, the net for the clients here, is that they will have a return of, nothing complicated here, those clients' returns will be 6.5%. So that 6.5% is really what they'll get. And when we report a return to them, that's what we're going to report. It's not right. In fact, it's illegal to tell them that they got an 8.5% return if we're charging a 2% MER. The return that they will report is 6.5%. So that's our mutual fund. Nothing to it, a fairly straightforward structure. Now, one other thing that will happen is when the dealer actually sells this fund, this would be the agent or advisor or broker or whatever the case is, there is going to be a sales charge applied here. And that sales charge can be charged a number of different ways. It might be charged at the point of sale, or it might be charged when there's a redemption. It's what we call a back end or a backload fund. But at some point along the way, the person who sells the fund is going to want to get paid. Now, the segregated fund is a little bit different and a little more complicated, as you might expect. Here, we still have to have some clients, obviously. And we're going to still get those clients to invest that money. But now, we're actually not going to directly invest the client's money. Instead, we're going to build a reserve here, much the same way as we have a reserve with insurance products. And that reserve basically means the client's money is kept safe. This is how our guarantees can be offered. Because we have a chunk of money sitting aside here that's relatively safely invested, and that money is how we fund those guarantees. Again, not much different than an insurance reserve. At the same time, using their own money, what'll happen here is the insurer takes their own dollars, and that's what actually gets invested. And hopefully, we get some gains there. And those gains, just like in a mutual fund, will go back to the client. But this process is different than what happens in a mutual fund. The client's money is never actually invested. It's the insurer's money that's invested. So the insurer has to have a pool of available capital to make this work. This is why we call this a segregated fund, because these investments are segregated from the insurer's general assets. So you have different pools of money involved here, different segregated pools of money. Now, another difference between our segregated fund and our mutual fund is in the regulatory requirements. So we said our mutual fund uses a simplified prospectus. Our segregated fund does not use a prospectus. It uses the annual information folder, or sometimes just referred to as the information folder. The annual information folder is the document that describes the workings of that fund. This is where you would look to see what your guarantees are. This is where you would look to see what type of resets you have. This is where you would look to see whether your fund uses the linear or proportional method for calculating new guarantees after withdrawal. This is where you would look to see what your management expense ratio is. So the annual information folder is where we provide disclosure for a segregated fund client. The simplified prospectus is where we provide disclosure for a mutual fund client. And a typical MER for a seg fund, because it's a little more complicated, because there's a little more work, it would be pretty normal to see about 0.5% higher than a comparable mutual fund. So if you have a Canadian equity mutual fund, it might have an MER of 2%, whereas a segregated fund invested also in Canadian equities might have a 2.5% MER. And that's really the downside of segregated funds. Maybe 0.5% doesn't sound like a lot, but when you take 0.5% and you compound the effects of that over 20 or 30 or 40 years, whatever the investment cycle happens to be for this investor, it does start to cost you money. So those are the basic structural differences between mutual funds and segregated funds. This is almost like we're looking at it from the insurer's perspective or from a regulatory perspective. But it is useful to understand this to see where our guarantees come from and really how the insurance company is making this product work. Thank you very much.